What's up? Today we are discussing Keith Haring's 8 most expensive paintings. This show is inspired by me recently going to a Keith Haring show in L.A. It was the weekend that they had the quote-unquote hurricane. Scared the hell out of me. Nobody else in L.A., including my girl, gave a damn about the hurricane. Either way, I went to this, I went to the Broad, beautiful museum in L.A., and saw these huge Keith Haring pieces, bro. And I never in my life knew that his pieces were that huge. Pause. That sounds crazy. Especially with Keith being gay, bro. But his pieces were, they were huge, they were colorful, they were vibrant. And although he is known as an artist that makes his art for everybody, literally the name of the exhibit was Artist for Everybody. And you can see with this Keith Haring shirt I have on, I also got a few Keith Haring posters. I got a poster specifically from that show that was dope. I got it framed up. And to get it framed cost way more than it actually cost to have the poster. And I say all that to say he made, one of his things was to make sure everybody could get the art. So if you're not up on Keith Haring, get tapped in. He's a dope artist to look into. We're about to look into him a lot today. We're talking about his 8 most expensive paintings. I like Keith Haring, bro, because he was into social activism. And as a white dude back then, he didn't really have to be. But I know as a gay dude, he probably seen so much discrimination and oppression. He's probably like, hell no. And a lot of times, the oppressed, they relate to other oppressed people. So anyway, he spoke out against apartheid. He spoke out for gay rights, racism, all kind of shit, bro. So we finna get into him. He also popularized art merch. And by doing so, people saying that he was cheapening the art. Like, you know, what he did was kind of like that Banksy vibe, but just make sure everybody can see it. This ain't just for the rich. So shout out to Keith Haring. We about to get into that today. I'm your boy Joshua Black, by the way. Comedian Joshua Black. Welcome to the show. Welcome to the show. We're going to be talking about a lot of stuff. I'm about to pull up Keith Haring's paintings. Thank you if you're just tuning in. But we got a lot of stuff to talk about today, man. I got notes. I ain't streamed in a couple weeks. But we're talking about the best album artwork today. Supreme and Timbaland got a collab. I'm going to Chicago next month for a comedy show that I'm headlining at Zany's. We're talking about all that. And hold on. Let me see if I can. Let me delete this. Hold on. That's from last stream. But it's a beautiful Tuesday morning, man. I'm glad to be back in the grind of it. If y'all back at work, man, you know, don't work too hard, bro. Really, screw all that, honestly. Don't let them work you too hard. Hold on real quick. I'm going to get my screen capture up. I don't know why this thing ain't, it's been a couple weeks since I've been on this stream, bro. All right, here we go. But Keith Haring, man, that exhibit was so fire when I went to L.A. I don't know if it's still up. I know it started in May. I think it might be over with. I went out there somewhat sort of recently, but hold on. Here we go. All right, here we go. We're talking Keith Haring's most expensive paintings. This one right here is hard right here. I'm going to zoom in on this. I love the colors that he used and the simplicity of his art, bro. He kind of reminds me of a, Keith Haring kind of reminds me of a young Jeezy. Because a lot of people were, because of it's the simplistic style. People were saying that Jeezy couldn't rap. You know what I mean? Like people were saying Bob Dylan couldn't sing, or people saying that, you know, the Keith Haring, you know, paintings are just are simple. But there's messages in simplicity, and there's power in simplicity, meaning like, but a kid needs to be able to look at a painting and get it and understand it, as well as a grown-ass intellectual that's 80 years old. And I think Jeezy did that same thing. He didn't have bars like Jay-Z or Nas or Common. But the stuff he was saying, although it was very simple technically, was way more powerful than a lot of stuff that people were putting out, bro. So I think Keith Haring's kind of like that. It was like, it's chill, it's simple, it's thick-lined, but he has some powerful stuff in here, especially if it's going for 6.5. This was an untitled, 6.5. Imagine having an untitled piece of art that's going for 6.5 million right here. That's crazy. Untitled. This is 1982. We're talking about Keith Haring's 8 most expensive paintings. This one's going for $6.5 million. Later on, we're going to go through some Keith Haring interviews. Man, he had some really dope things to say back in the day. And also, I want to get into his Andy Warhol collab that he did. I thought that was just hilarious and really cool. So shout out to Keith Haring, man. This one right here is going for 5.8 million. Golly. This, I feel like, I don't know if this, I don't know what this is called. Is this Untitled too? But this remind me of niggas breakdancing. You know what I mean? Back in the day. And I guess niggas in New York still might be breakdancing. And just, you know, they when they finally hit that special move on you, bro, hit that, when niggas start spinning on his head, it's over with. Like, I don't care what kind of dance crew you got. Once dudes was dancing and get on that head and get to spinning, by the time he's spinning, you're not supposed to let him spin, bro. By the time he get on his back and doing all the leg motion, you're supposed to stop it or say, it's my turn. But if a man get to this and he's on his head spinning and shit, bro, it's a good chance it's over for you, bro. Responding to the heyday, I don't know. Oh, yeah, exactly. New York hip-hop scene, which Haring loved. It seemed fitting that this painting's provenance traces a life that seems to have lived wholly in New York. Yeah. Let me see. The work executed in the enamel and dayglow. Yeah. It reminded me of hip-hop immediately. I think that's what they're saying. I don't know what the hell all them extra words were in that. But this is from myartbroker.com, by the way. Shout out to them for providing this list. This one's going here for 5.6 million. It's called Silence Equals Death. That's hard. I don't know what this is on. I don't know if this is a canvas or what. I don't know how it's like triangle like this. But that's hard. And I like all the figures on here doing the hear no evil, see no, you know, that type of shit when niggas are scared to speak up. I was a fireman before I was a comedian, and I dealt with a lot of that. Here in Nashville, when I was a fireman, bro, it was, you know, I was getting suspended a lot for doing my comedy. Rather it be prank phone calls, rather it be political content that nobody in the fire department agree with because they all are super, super MAGA. A lot of people, bro, they were just hating, bro. And instead of, you know, helping me and having my back, a lot of black firemen, although I had a lot of black issues I was talking about and discussing, and although they agreed with me and thought the treatment was unfair, bro, a lot of them was like, man, I can't say nothing, you know, or even going so far as to say, man, he tripping, he bullshitting, why is he, you know, talking about racism, and, you know, why is he talking truth to power? He gonna get, you know, and I believe, like, this painting, or like the title of this painting says, Silence is Death. What do you mean, my nigga? What do you mean? Why am I doing that? Why am I talking about that? What the hell? They were just doing extra stuff, bro. My boy went into a fire one time, and he's a black dude. He's fighting the fire. It's, you know, super hot, of course. And a white fireman just pushed him and took his fire hose, bro. That's his lifeline. He said, move, you a rookie. It's my turn. I'm taking this. You know what I mean? But he said it disrespectful. They're not cool. They're not friends. He pushed that nigga through him and then started spraying. And then when the fire is over and they come outside and my homeboy pick his old ass up off his feet, throw him on the ground and threaten to whoop him, now they want to punish my homeboy. Saying, what are you doing? But the white dude, he don't get no punishment. And that's throughout all fire departments. You see what I'm saying? And you expect me to just sit there and not say nothing? I'm not built like that. So silence is death. I feel that on a whole nother level, bro. And niggas that want to be silent when it's go time, I can't respect it. Of course, there are some times where you got to be chill. And it's time to, you know, it's time for isolation. It's time for relaxing. It's time for not, you know, it ain't wartime all day. But when it's on, it's on. And especially when you're doing something for the culture and you're doing something for your people, bro, and they need you and niggas is quiet, I can't respect it. Now, of course, I think that message was probably for white folks saying, hey, use your, you know, white privilege to help minorities and those who are oppressed. So that silence is death too. But the one I'm talking about is like coon-ass niggas, man. All right. 4.3 for Untitled. Golly, this is hard. I love the details in this one. What's up if you're just tuning into the stream, man? I can't see your, I can't see if you're in the chat right now. I'll get back to the chat in like 5 minutes. Well, it's your boy, Joshua Black. We're talking about Keith Haring's 8 most expensive paintings. Later, we're talking about the best album work of 2023. It was a lot of dope albums. I love the Offset album artwork. Who else has some dope stuff? We're going to get to a whole list of albums. We'll give a little teaser real quick. What the hell? Lil Yachty had a dope one. Uzi, of course. Drake with the Adonis drawing for that. We're going to go to the best album art of 2023. Supreme and Timbaland got a collab. And also, I'm going to Chicago, man. I want to talk about art in Chicago. But this right here is called The Last Rainforest, going for 4.2 ski. golly. And I hate to say this, man. This is going to sound ignorant to me, man, but I spend dollars mostly. I don't even know what the fuck this sign is, bro. But I know that it's whatever this is, it's more in American dollars. So whatever that means. I don't know if that's a fucking franc or Frank Ocean or, you know, a peso, a lentil. I don't know, bro. Considered Haring's last great masterpiece, The Last Rainforest more than doubled its low estimate when it sold at Sotheby's, one of the horriblest names other than Ruth's Chris to say. Sotheby's and Ruth's Chris. But anyway, it sold at Sotheby's in London on the 28th of June, 2016. And it was the second highest lot of the night. Golly. All right, this one right here is going for $5.4 million. Golly. This is Untitled to Acrobats. This is dope. I love the style of this. I love how it's black and white, but I can still see the motion in it. I still see the figure somehow, although it was really busy. This dude's probably got the most popularized style of lines, you know, we've ever seen. This painting's going for 5.7. Was this more than what was the last one? Last one, 5.4. This one's going for 5.7. It's Untitled. Did this nigga ever name his work? Keith just got busy, didn't he? Golly. This Untitled's 1986. We're talking about Keith Haring's 8 most expensive paintings. This is $5.7 million for this one. And this sold in 2021. And you got to assume it's all going to double. Or at least go up by 30 to 50% in its when it's sold again. If these niggas decide to sell it. I couldn't sell it. I would feel too crazy. I'll feel too crazy having a Keith Haring painting in my house or just in my possession, selling it one day, and then 5 years seeing somebody else sell it, and they getting triple the amount. And it ain't just the money, but it's just like I'll never have that back again. And even if I do get it again, I got to pay quadruple. It's just I couldn't get rid of it, bro. So a lot of these are priceless to me, if not all of them. This is a self-portrait for Tony. I don't know if Tony was his lover or what he got going on. It's like he got hearts in his eyes. I don't know. Although all of Haring's paintings were deeply personal, he seldom created self-portraits. This rare work was a gift to his friend and art dealer, Tony Shavrazi, who helped establish Haring's commercial success. Okay, so maybe they wasn't lovers. That was just, you know, somebody that helped him in the game. The self-portrait's use of Ben Day dots could be a homage to Roy Lichtenstein. I don't know if I said that correctly. But the coffee's hot. I tried something new in my coffee today because it's Christmas time, man. I'm going to go back to my real screen. We're going to get back to Keith Haring in a minute. We're talking about Keith Haring's 8. Uh-oh, hold on. Here we go. We're talking about Keith Haring's 8 most expensive paintings. But I'm on some new stuff today. I got this, I got a hot coffee. And because it's Christmas time now, I decided to, I should put eggnog in it instead of creamer. I don't know. You know what I mean? I don't know if people do that, but I'm starting to love eggnog, man. I'm starting to love eggnog, and you know, I'm feeling real festive. This comes randomly with me. You know, I get like fall starts coming around. I start putting sweaters and hoodies on. It's time for pumpkin spice, and now it's winter time. It's getting a little more cold. I always love a good coffee, but now I'm sipping on that eggnog. I got the Evan Williams over there. I was sipping that the last few days. I love that. But then I realized I want eggnog in, like, the morning. You know what I mean? I want eggnog at, like, 8 in the morning, 9 in the morning, but I can't be drinking no goddamn Evan Williams at no 8 in the morning, fam. That's sick. That's gross. And I found myself, like, I was like, man, I hope it's 12 o'clock so I can at least, because that's my cutoff. I can't drink before 12, no matter what the case is. So I'm like, and I find myself waiting for 12 so I can drink the eggnog. I said, bro, I need to just get some eggnog, man. So my guy got me some eggnog, bro, and I seen it this morning, and I seen it by the creamer. I was about to put some creamer in my coffee. But then I grabbed the eggnog. I said, man, should I just put the in it? You know, I ain't gonna lie, it ain't hurting it. But I'm gonna keep it a buck with you. It ain't as good as you would think it would be. I don't know why I said it would be like that, but it ain't as good as you think it would be, bro. It's some decent. It's some decent at best. But let's get back to Keith Haring. Also, you niggas got to stop distressing your genes so much. I just got to take a break to say that. Stop distressing the genes so much. And I don't know if it's you going home and distressing them yourself. And I'm talking about dudes who distress the jeans. They start the distressing at the upper thigh, and they distress all the way down to the ankle, to the point where it's barely a pair of jeans. You really just got loose threads hanging together. You know what I mean? It used to just be let a nigga knee out or put a little cut down here. But now I'm just seeing niggas who barely have pants on. And it's just stressed all the way down. I think Air Apostle went through a phase where they were just distressing. Just cut it a whole. Slow your roll with the distress. Because you're going over distress and ruining distress. For niggas like me who like to just sprinkle a little distress in the game. You sprinkle your distress on your jeans, bro. And sometimes I see it on the jacket. People throw the jean jacket on. And it's like every time you get up, you leaving threads on the ground. You leaving like part of your denim on the ground. What's come on, man? So slow down with the distressed jeans. And I'm going to tell you who the main, I don't know if proprietor is even the word for that. But the main person who, or the main people I see responsible for the extra distressed jeans is City Gear. In these ratchet ass spots where you can get Jordans and shit at, because I see jeans hanging up in there and they distressed. They got 17 pockets on them. Stop with the distressing. So I'm gonna get back to Keith Haring, but I just give a quick PSA. The distressing is getting too much. But let's get back to we talking about oh shit, hold on. Let me get back to my screen. We talking about Keith Haring's 8 most expensive paintings. If you're just tuning in, thank you for coming to the live stream. It's your boy, comedian Joshua Black. This painting right here is untitled, and it's going for $4.2 million. I like the colors of this. I rarely see Keith painting on dark colors like a black. And as a dude who myself is a visual artist, and I've had 2 exhibits here in Nashville, Tennessee, did a few murals. My first exhibit actually sold out every single piece, and my second exhibit sold half. That ain't just a flex, but I'm saying that to let you know that I understand the difficulty of trying to paint on a dark surface. When I first started painting, I'm like, God, none of these colors are hidden. Because when you paint on that dark surface, it's a little harder. Ironically, it reminds me of doing black rooms in comedy. Black rooms are way harder to do your fucking jokes at, because you got to be faster. The expectations are higher. The standards are higher for humor. So when I do comedy in a black room, I'm not really, it's time to get at it, because you don't really have time to play up there. In white rooms, sometimes they'll give you what they call the benefit of the doubt. So you can start off horrible. And then if you really keep trudging on, you might can win them back. But that's almost impossible in a black room. Once niggas start booing you and getting on their phone and going live and shit, it's over for you. So anyway, that kind of reminds me of that. That black excellence, if you will. All right, this one's called Sister Cities for Tokyo, going for $4.4 million, bro. Who is buying these? Which one of y'all got them Keith Harings in your crib? Haring's Sister Cities for Tokyo was created to mark the 25th anniversary of New York City and Tokyo's Sister Cities friendship in 1985. The artist first visited Tokyo in 83 and will return to the Japanese capital numerous times in the 1980s. All right, here the artist imagines the two cities as an iconic dancing figure. Okay. Joined together under one heartbeat. Okay, I got to get over to Tokyo, bro. I never really, I seen a lot of their fashion style. I like that. I like a lot of their, especially with the pants and their cuts and the silhouettes of that Japanese streetwear is dope. But I got to get over there, man. They love hip-hop, goddamn. They love streetwear. So shout out to Tokyo, man. If you in Tokyo, man, drop a comment. Let me know what's a dope spot to come out there and kick it at. Do y'all do comedy out there? Let's get it popping. I go out there with a goddamn, with a translator or something, and see if these jokes going. All right, this is probably the gayest painting I've ever seen right here. This was going for $4.2 million. But he was on demon time with this one, bro, because he got my boy Mickey Mouse spreading them Chicos. He got Mickey spreading his cheeks for some random heart. He was on, this looks like he was on demon time, bro. And for some reason, Mickey Mouse hard as a bitch. So, hey, shout out to y'all whoever bought this one. The Star Lot of Bonham's Post-War and Contemporary Art Auction in May, blah, blah, blah. Untitled, sold for over 8 times more than the second highest artwork. Golly, yeah, that's a crazy one right here. That's a crazy one, bro. But yeah, all right, this one going for 3.3 million. Shout out to you if you just checked into the live stream. I'm your boy, Joshua Black, man. We are talking about Keith Haring's 8 most expensive paintings. Later on in the show, we got best album artwork we're going to be talking about. Supreme and Timbaland are doing a collab boot. I don't know if I'm feeling it. We're going to get into that. I'm going to Chicago, Zanies. I'm headlining January 21st at Zanies in Chicago. I cannot wait. So we're going to break down what the hell I'm going to be doing in Chicago. I want to check out some art galleries out there, some museums, a good place to get some coffee. And I got to get y'all to come to the show. So we're going to talk about Chicago in a minute. And then I'm glad we crossed that out. I just wrote on this paper, discuss distressed jeans. And I'm glad I got that off my chest. But anyway, man, welcome to the live stream. 3.3 million for this one. I like it. I don't know what he was going for with this, but what I see is I see a man getting kicked, a nigga kicking a hole in a man, and look, he got a cross on his face. You know what I mean? So, of course, my mind initially goes to, and, you know, beauty is in the eye of the beholder, man. So if you paint something, whatever I interpret it is, that is my truth, and that is what it means. The same with you. Don't feel intimidated to try to interpret something. Whatever the hell it feels like to you, that's what it is, nigga. It can feel like the complete opposite to somebody else, and that's true, too. But to me, I see a nigga with his hands up with a cross on his face and somebody kicking a hole in him. That's what I see in this, bro. And what that means to me is I see, this is just my interpretation, but I know Christianity as a religion ain't been too kind to the gays. And, you know, they got the right to believe whatever they want to believe. You think gay people going to hell? Hell, I don't give a damn. Do you? I ain't gay. I ain't a Christian. I ain't really in that. But, if I was gay, I would understand why I would say, fuck you, hell. If you saying screw me, I'm going to hell and I'm a bad person, hell, I would draw something like this too, nigga. Me kicking somebody in the face who got a cross on them because that cross is starting to represent oppression to me. You know what I mean? That cross is starting to represent disrespect to me, arrogance, some kind of shunning of me. And it's like, fuck all that. Not necessarily screw Jesus and your religion or, you know, you individually. But, you know, I can see how somebody get to the point where it's like, man, fuck y'all, bro. Especially black people in the South. Y'all know how it be to go into a restaurant and you're the only black, especially back then. Like, I'm in Nashville now, and it's a little more progressive now. But I had dreadlocks down to my, like, chest a while back, bro. And I'm tall, I'm 6'3". So I'm going to a restaurant, and I'm going to the good restaurants in town. It might be downtown. It might be where a lot of tourists at, a lot of white folk in general at. And Nashville is very segregated. Black folk only go where black folk go, and white folk stay over there. You know what I mean? So if I'm trying to go get some food over here, I might be the only nigga in there. So I'm the only black person in there a lot of times, and niggas just staring or just looking, or what I took it as is trying to make me uncomfortable. That's what I took it as. Because, nigga, if you come to TSU homecoming as a white person, I'm not finna just be staring a hole in you while you walk down the street. And if I'm doing that and my whole family's doing that, we feel like we trying to make you feel uncomfortable. And don't nobody try to make me feel uncomfortable. That's no racist. You know what I mean? So I would always just make him look. I'm either going to say something crazy to you and make everybody uncomfortable and let you know I don't give a fuck. You know what I mean? But I say all that to say, I'm sure, I don't even know what I said all that to say, bro. I was about to lie and go through a soliloquy or something else, but I forgot why I said that. I know we're talking about Nashville, and we started with this, with people oppressing, so it probably had something to do with just oppression anyway, but yeah, it is what it is on that. 2.9 million for this. No, I'm sorry. 4.8 million for this one. My love when you go to that grayscale, that black and white, bro. This is hard. It's untitled again. My nigga was just working, not titling nothing. This one's going for 4.5. We way past the 8 most expensive. I'm giving you extra credit now. This is extra credit work. I told you I'd give you the 8 most expensive. We done gone. This is number 12, 13. We still going, bro. 4.5 for this one, untitled, and they said it might be called Dancing Dogs. I love this one, especially with the dog on my shirt. I love how he drew the dogs. And almost 16 feet wide. Golly, Dancing Dogs is a gigantic depiction of one of Haring's most iconic motifs, the barking dog. Painted in 1981, the work is one of the earliest canvases to depict this theme. Okay. It stands out for its rapid brush strokes and dripping paint that falls down the canvas, almost a combination of pop art and abstract expressionism. The work was also offered at Sotheby's in New York on May 14th. That is hard. I'm going to take a sip of this coffee, man. Hold on. I want to welcome y'all to the stream, man. It's your boy, Joshua Black. We getting to it. I'm feeling good, man. I'm feeling good. I've been writing a lot. I've been going out to a lot of I've been going out to a lot of mics, been doing a lot of shows, man. Just been trying to get better. Cause you know it's that time of year where it's time for New Year's resolutions. It's time for revamping. It's time to, you know, look back at yourself and say, damn, what have I done this year? What do I like that I've done this year? What can I do next year? That's a little better. So I'm in that mode. I'm in like better myself mode. I'm in like, let's clean up, you know, the clutter, you know, like emails type shit. You know what I mean? Like even even shoes and shit first, because cleaning just kind of is therapeutic to me anyway, but I kind of want to clean out the clutter, bro. So that's kind of the vibe I'm in, man. I'm in grind mode. I don't feel like such a slave to the algorithm anymore. And as a content creator, we always deal with the hustle and the bustle of the content, man. It's a whole other grind than stand-up comedy. Stand-up comedy is its own thing. You got to stand. You got to wake up. You got to write jokes. You got to go out there and perform the jokes. You got to come back, tweak the jokes, and then perform them again. You got to do this over and over. That's a grind in itself. Then you got to find yourself to even figure out what you want to write about. That's all stand-up comedy. But then in content creation, nigga, you got to – it's different. You got to find out what's popping, what's trending, what's going on. You got to work yourself within doing that. You can't – in stand-up comedy, once a joke hit, you can keep it. And you can keep working on that thing when people come see you. On content, you can't – give them shit from 2 years ago, from last year, from 2 weeks ago. You got to keep it cooking, bro. So that's its own demanding beast. And I've been working with that too, man. So I've been working on getting a system and not being such a slave to the algorithm, because it can get to a point where it's like, oh shit, this is trending, I got to talk about this. Or that's going on, I got to talk about that. Oh, this is going on, I got to get on that. And I feel like sometimes that makes content kind of McDonald's-ish, kind of fast food-ish. It kind of cheapens it, you know? It kind of forces the speed over quality. And speed is a great skill to have, bro, but quality is good too, especially when you want to look back on your work and be proud of it. So anyway, I want to welcome y'all to the live stream. It's your boy, Joshua Black. Right now, we're talking about Keith Haring's 8 most expensive paintings. We did that. I want to go back to Keith Haring, but right now I want to discuss some of the best album artwork of 2023. Who had the best album artwork? This is not albums. Who had the best album artwork of 2023? Albums that come to mind when I think of the best artwork in 2023, just off top, I'm gonna have to go through it and see, because of course there's some I forgot, and then there's some I don't even know about, because I see some on here already that I haven't known. But I initially think, because it was just so soon, this right here, the Drake for the Dogs. I love it because, of course, it was a I just love this style of art, to be honest with you. The Basquiat style, the childish, kind of the raw. So I'm going to put, what the fuck, I was trying to sell something. I'm going to put Drake over here, and then we're going to look at all of them. So what we're going to do is pick the best from the list, and then we're going to try to narrow that down to a top 10 list of the best album artwork. So let's see what we got here. I'm gonna just pick out things that scream to me visually. I love the Yachty. I like this one. Yachty's really good with the visuals, and this album's pretty good, man. It didn't sound like anything I've ever heard from him before. It was sonically different. I really like it. All right, let's see what we got here. Oh, that's my girl from Paramore. I like this actually. Let's put this in there. The Paramore album. This Is Why. I like that. All right, hold on. The Uzi's dope. The Uzi one is dope, but I just don't want to pick that one. Let me see. Something about this is cool. I'm not on these people right here. Who is Sampha Lahai? I'm not on them. I'm going to check this album out, but I love the artwork, so they definitely going in. What's up? If you just tune into the live stream, it's your boy Joshua Black. We are looking at the best album artwork of 2023. We're looking for the best 10. And let's get a 10. I like this right here. I don't even know who this is. Red Moon and Venus. Cali Uchis. Forgive me. I know. And also, if I pass your album, forgive me. This ain't nothing personal. It's just what's calling me at the moment. Gotta love that Tyler Creator. Call Me or Get Lost. Great album. Great album with DJ Drama on it. And I'm from that era of DJ Drama and those mixtapes. So that was dope. We're looking for the best album artwork. Whatever this is fire. Raven Khalil. That looks kind of like spooky, but like cool. We're looking for best album artwork, man. Because I think album artwork, it's like a lost art, man. People just throwing stuff up. It ain't like back in the day. And people sometimes doing that with their videos now. It's like, yo, this is supposed to be special, you know? Oh, shit. Hold on. I'm trying to put this in a folder, and it's acting very dumb. But, yeah, you know, people, I feel like people sleeping on how important the album artwork is, bro. This is super cool from Skrillex. All right. Let's see. The Andre was some cool. The Thug is dope, but it's just too sad for me. I don't, you know what I mean? So I'm not going to put that in there because the reality of it. It's like some art is dope, but it's too sad to be in my house. Like sometimes I've even painted some stuff and I loved it. And there's a message that I wanted out there, but I would never hang it up in my house because I don't want to feel like that. I just wanted to express that. But that's kind of like that with that Young Thug. I don't want to think about Atlanta rappers going to jail. That's not, you know what I mean? All right, let's see. Okay. This is hard. I don't even know who this is. Census designated. We're going to look into that. We're looking at the best album artwork of 2023. Put something down in the chat if you see something that's screaming. Or if you just know something. If you know something, even if it's a friend of yours or an indie artist from your town. If you got some dope album artwork, send it in. Put it in the chat. I'll Google it. We'll see what it's talking about. Post Malone, who we got here, that Sam Smith. This is dope. I'm not really a Kesha fan. I'm not like a, I don't hate her. I don't know her music, but that's a dope album artwork. Killer Mike, that's cool. That's Trippy. His name is Trippy Red. That makes sense. The Gunna. I like the album a lot. I don't know if I'm going to throw that album cover specifically in there, but that was a really great album. and it's like I like how he gave his perspective on everything today. But you know, it's like he came out of jail and there was a lot of speculation about him and people were saying a lot online. And he came out and actually gave us an album that sounded good and he was giving his perspective on things that were currently happening in his life. So it's like, damn. So I just respect that as art because people don't do that. A lot of times people have something going on in their life, you drop an album and it's just they talking about cars and rims and drugs. Like, nigga, what about what happened? We just saw what happened. Like, where's the vulnerability? You know what I mean? Where's the risk taking, the boldness? You know what I mean? So I like that he took it there. And he was talking crazy on there. So shout out to that. This is one of the spookiest albums I've ever seen right here. Album covers. This is wild. That is wild right there. Sundial. I'm gonna have to get on that. All right, who else we got right here? Man, it was a beautiful year in music for album artwork, honestly, bro. If y'all got something, put it in the chat. If you got something, put it in the chat right now. We're talking about the best album artwork of 2023. It is a beautiful Tuesday morning, I guess it still is. It's 11 o'clock, count as morning. We're looking for best of 2023. I think this looks kind of spooky here. And it's giving me some cool albums to go back on and, like, listen to. Because I ain't, you know, some of these I have no idea who these people are. They just got really dope album artwork. And so put in the chat, if you know when it's good music to be listening to. I love this Dirk album, man, but I hate the blood in the eyes type shit. Although that's real and I get what he's saying and it matches what the album is talking about. Blood in the eyes, dog, and I can't see. I just can't. I don't like it, bro. I just hate, you know. But I get it. The album's called Almost Healed. He's supposed to be beat down like that. All right, I think we got. All right, these are according to me, these are some of the best. I wonder if it'll just let me. Hold on. We're trying to find the best album artwork of 2023. And let's see if I can. All right, that's how we're going to do it. Shit. I'm going to bring all these. I guess we'll. I'm gonna see how I can pull them all in just like a fucking. All right. I guess I'm gonna try to find my best album. Oh fuck! Not I'm fucking lost it. All right, here we go. All right, if we're trying to find our top 10 album artworks of 2023, that's what we're trying to find, the top 10. Oh, well, let's see. Let's go. I'm going to rank it down. How many do we have in here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. 15 albums. All right, we got 15. I'm going to narrow it down to the top 10. Let's go ahead and... I'm loving this one. This one is probably I'm gonna go and pick my five favorite album artworks of 2023. This is it. I love the simplicity of it. I love the blackness of it. I love the spookiness of it. I mean, you're looking at the pupils, bro. I can't even see no pupils. This person appears to be drowning, bro, but it's like they chilling with it though. They cool with that. It's like, or are they floating? Because that you might just be floating, but this seems like a big bottle of water. How funny would that be if she was in a bottle of water? It's like, how small is this motherfucker? But she appears to be in a huge body of water. I assume it's a woman. Yeah, I don't know why I even think that, but it looks good. Maybe it could be a man. I don't know. But this is hard. So I'm going to check out the album on that alone. Let me see. Nah, that one's cool, too. Let's go and check this out. This one's cool, too, on just some creepy. This is called, I think it's called This Stupid World. That's cool, just on some creepy. We've seen The Raven. Now, this one is wild. Yo, this is scary right here. Like, wow, I don't know why it's so intense. I love the like, collage of feel is. I love that little fish star. I love the white dots background, the gray hair that's just all over the place. The intense eyes looking dead at you. Bro, this is wild. I can't even tell you the emotion that this is expressing. I don't know. Because the more I look at it, it gets calmer, then it gets angry, then it gets like old, then it gets young. I don't know what this is, bro. This is a wild piece of art, bro. So shout out. I think this may be the best album artwork of 2023 right here. Between this and that Raven, I'm going to keep going through. Let me see it. That was dope, too. The Yachty was dope. But hold on. This is cool. Maybe I'm just on creep vibes today because all the ones I picked them feel kind of creepy. Hold on. Yeah, it is hard, too. Just the elevator. Just on some minimal, simple shit. Let me see. Thought this was dope. You know, I've kind of seen it before to a degree. I've seen people play with the hair and make it into art before. You know what I mean? But it still looks dope how she played with the colors. And, of course, those Buffalo boys always doing something real creative with their album artwork. I think this is up there, too. I love how they do, like, the Virgil, to where they'll take some artwork and then just put just a splash of them on it just so you know it's them. You know? I like that. Hold on. Call Me When You Get Lost was dope. I think I just like the album, so I'm biased. I just like the album so much. I'm like, oh, this got to be the coldest, too. You know what I mean? So I'm going to throw this up there just because I fuck with the album, bro. That Call Me When You Get Lost with DJ Drama was fire. This was Kesha right here. I thought this was incredible. It reminds me of Dexter, some wild shit. This is just intriguing. This makes me want to listen to the album right here. I don't know what she on, but it makes me uneasy. I have to breathe looking at it, and I like that. It's like evoking some real emotion. I like that. So that's up there, honestly. Of course, the fact that this kid did this, the fact that the all the hype around the album for the dogs, you got to respect this. You got to respect it. Because a lot of kids draw some real dumb shit, let's be honest. And they say, hey, look, mommy, look at this. And you got to hang it up and you hate it. But honestly, this is some dope shit, bro. That's just dope. But I'm sorry, I think I'm still leaning with this is cool. This reminds me of the vibe I'm on right now, just like the chill country vibes. You know what I mean? This is just kind of where I'm at right now, so I'm feeling that one. But I think the cream of the crop going to have to be that spooky black chick. Hold on, let's go find her again. All this is cool, bro. We're talking about this right here. Just because how it makes you feel. You know what I mean? I got to get back on this album. Because just alone how this makes me feel. I'm not on this artist at all, but just alone how that makes me feel, I got to rock with that. But anyway, we're about to get back to, oh, that's right. Supreme had a drop today. Let's check out this Supreme drop. What's up? Welcome to the stream, by the way. It's your boy, Joshua Black. I want to thank y'all for tuning in. I don't even know how long we've been streaming. Maybe about 45. I literally can't even call it. It's my first time back streaming in about a week, man. I took a little time off. Well, from streaming, not time off. For real. But took a break from streaming just to kind of gather myself, figure out, you know, the next motion, how you want to keep it moving, you know. But we're doing this every day, twice a day. A lot of times we're going to do it from 10 to 12 and probably a late night show, 8 to 10 type shit, depending on if I got mics and shit that night. But I want to check out this Supreme drop. Where is it at? All right. Supreme and Timbaland have a new boot collab. Let's get straight into it. Are you feeling it or are you not? Let's get straight into it. I don't think they've dropped the price for these yet. I don't know if they dropped the price, but let's zoom in on them. Here they go right here. They coming in pink. Excuse me. Pink, wheat, and black. And as we zoom in on them, here they are right here. We got the Supreme logo right here by the tree. I mean, it's kind of simple, but at the same time, kind of busy. I mean, first thoughts, bro. First thoughts, I'm not feeling this. I'm going to keep it a buck with you. I'm just not, like, it just don't, I don't know, bro. I'm not into the little, I get the I know it's a construction boot, and like, that's a, this little design, this little raised thing is like a construction thing, and unfortunately, I know that because I've had to work so many random raggedy-ass construction jobs. Some construction jobs are good. Some niggas get a construction, a real gig where they really working on real projects, like a dope house or a dope hotel or a dope something, then you getting paid for real, bro. But I'm doing one-day jobs for a staffing company, bro. So I'm already traumatized and triggered by construction boots for real. You know what I mean? Because it's like, it reminds me of, you know, working for minimum wage, nigga. And now, mind you, in the staffing company's defense, I wasn't going out there and working. I would go in, clock in, pick up a hammer, pretend to do work. Soon as the supervisor leave, I'm going off and rolling up a joint, and I'm writing jokes. Because I don't give a shit about it. But at the same time, it was too hot out there, bro. It's Tennessee. 97 degrees out there, bro. And the Mexicans had the beers and shit. But I was like, I didn't want to drink that early. And then by the time I wanted to drink around about 2, 3, niggas, the beers was gone. And everybody, you know what I mean? So it's like, it just, so I'm not really in the construction energy. These pinks don't call my name. I don't know. They just look, they, I don't know, bro. Timberlands are already a little big and heavy for me anyway. I mean, I like Timberlands, of course. You know, you got to have a cool. But this, I ain't feeling it. That's my take on it. Y'all can tell me how you feel in the chat. If you feeling these, you feeling these, bro. And I'm not trying to step on no collab. Supreme, they clearly know what they're doing. Timberland clearly know what they're doing. And the streets love Supreme and the streets love Timberland. So I'm sure these are going to sell out. They ain't put a price on them yet, I don't believe. But I don't know, bro. I don't even know what I'm expecting. I know they've had something before. A nigga like me would just take, like, maybe just these, just the regular wheat Tims and just a cool little red Supreme logo. Just put the, throw the logo on it. I don't know, man. This kind of, or maybe that's how they laced. But I'm not feeling them, bro. I'm not feeling them. I'm going to tell you what I am feeling, though, that's dropping this week with Supreme, and that's the face mask. Because I was just saying, I was walking outside, you know, I'm trying to get my walks in, I'm trying to get my 3 miles a day in at least, at the very least, nigga, do 3 miles. Hell, I'm 34, but with that wind picking up, and I live in the city, bro, so, it's, you know, that sun sometimes is getting blocked by them buildings, and that wind, that wind come through them buildings, and nigga, start whooping your ass. And I'm like, I need a shiesty. You know what I mean? Nigga need one of them, a ski mask or a bandana or something, but I'm like, they gonna think I'm on demon time. And I don't want to just walk around, nigga, I'm a black man, 6'4", walking around downtown Nashville, nigga, with a shiesty on. Even if And it's not about caring what white people think or like, oh, no, white people are going to think of something. It's not about that. It's more about when I'm walking on these, when I'm trying to get my miles in, it's like I'm trying to think about jokes or think about sketches or I'm trying to, like, use that time. And sometimes it throws me off if I'm thinking about something and I see 10 people staring at me or whispering and pointing. They're like, you know what I mean? So now I can't think. So it's not that I give a fuck about what people think about me, really. It's just about I don't like niggas staring at me while I'm walking trying to think of something. It just throws me off. I say all that to say I don't want to get a shiesty, but I think I could get one of these, bro. Just a cool little mask. You know what I mean? This shit cool. It look warm. It's Gore-Tex. You know it's durable. Yeah, I'm doing this, bro. Because it don't look like no COVID shit. Because I don't want no Supreme COVID, man. You like a sick nigga to be fresh. You know what I mean? I don't want that, bro, but yeah, I might go for that sky blue boy. I really want the white print, though. Yeah, yeah, there we go. Right there, that North Carolina or that red. But yeah, so that's probably what I'm going to do this week if I do anything. They ain't put no ticket on them yet. If they get stupid with the price, I'm saying fuck it. Like, I ain't spending no more than $70 on these. And take it how you want to take it, nigga. I ain't doing it. But anyway, that's the Supreme job. I'm going to go back to these boots one more time, make sure I ain't miss nothing, bro. But and y'all leave it in the comments, but let me know if y'all are feeling this or if y'all are trying to cop these. They come out Thursday, I think. I'm good. And you know they just going to tear your head off. It's not enough. It's not enough. I don't really feel Supreme in this. I don't feel the collaboration. I feel like Timberland would have just dropped this on their own. You know what I mean? And the nigga would not have bought it. That's what it feels like. You know, and I get that you want to just put a little splash on it, and, you know, but it just don't feel like I don't see Supreme. I see, but maybe on some New York shit, maybe y'all fuck with that. On some NY time, and maybe that's what it's about. I know it's Supreme an NY company anyway. Tim's a New York thing. Maybe it ain't for a Southern nigga like myself. You know what I mean? And I got to respect that. Maybe it ain't for a Southern man like myself. Now, I want y'all tell me if I'm tripping for this real quick. I was driving through my hood the other day. North Nashville is where I was born and raised at. Let me scoot over a little bit. I like symmetry. But yeah, I'm rolling through my hood the other day and I'm realizing they're building this huge, it was like a huge infrastructure they're building by a fashion force. And a fashion force is like a City Trends, a little hood store that sells, like, you know, Jabot jeans and fake Jordans and fake jewelry and scales and all kind of ratchet shit or whatever. But I go in there all the time to get my white tees for cheap, you know what I mean, something. But anyway, bro, they're building a bus stop. They're taking the main bus stop in Nashville that's downtown, and they're putting it in North Nashville, you know. And initially, as soon as I see it, I'm thinking it's some bullshit, bro. Because what it seems like to me now, I don't know, and a friend of mine's actually the mayor now, because Nashville's kind of tight like that. We just kind of close, and, you know, we just kind of know each other. It's a real community vibe here. So I might need to just hit him on and text him about this, and it started happening before he even got in office. But I know for a long time, the homeless people downtown, first of all, they be scaring the hell out of people. I will give it to the city. Yeah, homeless people downtown, they might be throwing shit at you or staring at you or jacking off or doing whatever. It's a lot of people downtown. You know what I mean? And a lot of times it's mental health issues going on that have been unchecked and undiagnosed and unhelped. And then you just throw a nigga on the streets, and that's what happens when mental health ain't checked on. You know what I mean? Or cared about, and the healthcare system is fucked up. But that's a whole nother story. But I say all that to say, bro, when you go downtown, Nashville, it's a very touristy energy. They want to make tourists feel comfortable, and they want to, you know. So a lot of times they'll put little spikes. I saw a church, ironically, spikes were sitting on a church. I forgot what you call them, but where a homeless person can't sleep there. So a homeless person can't sleep right here because they got spikes on the ground. Or they'll put something over here under a bridge where you can't sleep there, or they'll try to hide them over here. But now the new thing is, because we got a lot of tourists coming to Nashville, all the homeless people be downtown at the bus stop hanging out or catching the bus. They trying to move that into my hood. And I think it's just messed up on so many ways. First of all, you're just saying, all right, fuck them. We're not finna fix it. We're not finna help them. We're not finna do anything about them. We're just gonna actually put them over there because it's an eyesore. And where's over there? Where all the black folk be at? So I don't like how they just throw what they presume is trash, even though these people are not trash. What they just take is trash and just throw it in North Nashville and just say. So I don't know. Y'all tell me if I'm tripping, bro. But that seemed like some old bullshit. Why the hell is there a brand? And it's just, they ain't never built nothing out north. I ain't never seen no infrastructure from the city getting built out north ever. Not a fucking library. Not a fucking playground. And now niggas want to. I'm like, what's all this construction about? What's the hold up up here? You know, you drive and you're like, what the fuck? What's the hold up? And you look up there and they see they building a damn bus station. A nice one, too. So they can just drop off the homeless people over here and they can just keep selling their Nashville. But anyway, that was some random stuff I thought about. Man, let's talk about some. I'm going to Chicago. January 24th. I'm going to talk about that in just a second. Let me pull everything up. Here we go right here. I'm going to pause it. All right, yes. I am going to be in Chicago January 24th at Zany's Comedy Club headline. I cannot wait. I need you in the building if you're in Chicago. If you know somebody in Chicago, hit them up. Tell them your boy is coming to town and we doing it. But the first thing I need to know is like what kind of deep dish pizza I need to get. Where do I get the deep dish pizza? I also need to know about what kind of art galleries they got out there that I can check out. Some dope art museums. Well, last time I was up there, I actually proposed to my girl in Chicago. I'll put that picture in the post. But I love Chicago, man. I'm going. It's going to be cold as hell. But I want to know the history of deep dish pizza. Why did Chicago get this deep dish pizza? So that's what we're about to go into right now. I want to react to this video describing what the hell deep dish pizza is. I'm getting excited about my trip to Chicago. It's January 24th. I need you there, Chicago. I want to talk about this deep dish pizza. Let's see what this is.
Deep Dish Pizza is the story of Chicago.
Pizza's a matter of pride in Chicago.
Blue collar, broad-shouldered, hearty Midwestern stock.
You know, we have that Midwestern sensibility.
But as much as we love the deep dish.
That Midwest, Chicago, y'all hanging on to that Midwest, bro. I feel like y'all right above us. And we Central Time, y'all on Central Time. I don't know how y'all are just mid. Not mid as in being mid, I'm talking about like middle, bro. I don't know about Midwest, but anyway, y'all Midwest, go ahead.
Hi. Very few know it's tawdry history.
Rick Ricardo starts it.
I contend Rudy Malnati did.
For while Deep Dish is the story of Chicago, the story of Deep Dish is uniquely its own.
I think I've been to Uno's. I believe I went to Uno's downtown.
Recipe disputes.
There's really no conflict. My father had the recipe for the pizza.
To poaching cooks.
They actually hide outside of Pizzeria Uno and they wait for Alice Mae Redmond.
To straight up stab you in the bakery.
And Ike Sewell said, "You're not a partner."
I'm sure that they made promises to her.
My father-in-law didn't think he was going to make it.
So grab a slice of the deep stuff. We're about to weave a tale that'll have you thinking a true Chicago.
Who does it get me hungry? Let's get with the deep dish pizza.
Original.
We invented it, we perfected it, and it belongs to Chicago.
Chicago's Best presents Piece of the Pie, the scandalous history of deep dish pizza.
Let's get it. Talk to me about this deep dish Chicago. I'm coming to you January 24th. We at Zany's. We doing giveaways. I got a dispensary sponsoring it. We're turning up. We got beautiful giveaways coming to the show. I need you in the building January 24th. Let's talk about this deep dish pizza. Hold on. Too much music now. You're gonna get me jammed up.
Fire residence at the corner of Wabash and Ohio. But in the basement of this old house was a bar, and it was a rough place. The feds bust the bar. And so he takes over the old bar and makes this pizza that is very different from the traditional kind of pizza. Had Ricardo not created this pizza, the history of pizza would be entirely different.
Ricardo, shout out to you, my bro.
But thank the pizza gods he did, and thus concludes our telling of the history of deep dish pizza.
Well, so as far as deep dish goes.
Huh? Alternative facts.
Back in the 40s, a couple of partners got together on the near north side of Chicago at the corner of Ohio and Wabash. One was a guy named Ike Sewell, who was a former football player at the University of Texas, an All-American offensive lineman, and then his...
Y'all think he could ball or what, bro? What type of nigga got a sucker in his mouth in the 40s? I don't know about him, bro. I'm bullshitting.
Buddy, a guy named Richard Navarrete, who was affectionately known as Rick Ricardo. Now, Ike being from Texas, he felt that Chicago didn't have any good Mexican food.
Ike decided that what Chicago needed was a Mexican restaurant.
Penny Pollock, dining editor at Chicago Magazine.
So Rick enlists one
Penny, what it do, ski?
The guys who works in his kitchen, and Rick Ricardo, who had never tasted Mexican food in his life, got sick, totally hated it, and ended up disappearing from Chicago for 2 months.
Bet you're gonna tell
Damn, what that Mexican do to my bro?
He went to Italy and was dazzled by the Neapolitan style.
Dynamite here in Chicago.
Nailed it!
So the two of them are looking at each other like, all right, pizza it is. There's only one problem with that, and this happens a lot. You know, neither of them had any idea how to make pizza.
Excuse me, what?
I am totally mystified about stories that say that Rick Ricardo had no culinary experience.
Oh, it's on now.
He had an artist's sensibility and kind of a creativity and almost an irreverence, but he also had a food background.
Rick showed Ike versions of what he had had in Italy, and Ike Sewell, being a big brawny Texan, said, oh, I need something much more hefty, and maybe we need a knife and fork. So they kept building the pizza to be bigger and thicker and brawnier, and that's how Deep Dish was born.
That's hard. That sounds like some old... That sounds like an old Southern tale. That's like that's what we need to be doing this shit. Just I want more, make it bigger and fatter and stronger, more bread on it. You know what I mean? So that's dope. I like that story.
But like, let's just imagine they couldn't cook. Fill us in, John.
So what they do is they had to go out and find themselves a nice Italian guy by the name of Rudy Malnati Sr., an Italian immigrant.
Malnati, you say?
Now, up until then, pizza had been relatively small. Thin crust, more of an appetizer or a snack, as opposed to like a full-blown meal. And Ike being from Texas...
When was pizza invented in general? I'm gonna Google that while he's talking.
Because he felt that wasn't good enough. So, through his direction, Rudy Malnati Sr. helped create the deep dish pizza.
I'm probably the only person that knows the real story other than my mother.
Rudy Malnati Jr.
There's really no conflict. My father had the recipe for the pizza. Rick had the building, which was 29 East Ohio, where the, obviously, Pizzeria Uno sits now. And Ike Sewell was brought in for basically what he could do with bringing liquor to the restaurants.
So, on one side, we have the Ricardo camp. It must have been Rick.
Google saying pizza was invented the late 18th century, whatever the fuck that means.
Rick Ricardo starts it.
On the other is the Malnati folks. Who better than an Italian immigrant? Am I right?
I contend Rudy Malnati did. And then you can just start to add up the stories between, you know, what you hear over here and what you hear here. It starts to come together and give you an idea of what may have happened.
Does it though? What say we go to the source?
Okay, sure.
April Gavin from the Pizzeria Uno.
April, talk your talk. Let's get to the bottom of it.
The stance of our history is shrouded in mystery because Ike wasn't a journaler, neither was Navarrete, so we don't really know what they were thinking or exactly those conversations.
That's why I'm glad I got this live stream. For 10 years from now, all my ideas, I threw them out here, so nigga can't say, oh, who thought of that? Who thought of that? He was talking about it on the live stream.
What we do know is that Navarrete was an Italian guy. He made food for a living. He had an Italian dough recipe. It turns out, though, that Ricardo Navarrete died before any other deep dish pizza place in the city, including our second restaurant, Pizzeria Due, was open. So it sort of became Ike's legacy.
So what's the verdict? Last word, Penny.
People are greedy. They're terrible.
No, not if it's the truth.
I find every version of this plausible.
All right, that was dope, man. Those stores were actually pretty cool, and I'm glad. Oh shit, where the hell? Oh, that scared the hell out of me. I'm like, I know the live didn't go off. But yeah, that was dope, man. I want to get into some. I want to go into a Keith Haring interview real quick. And then I want to talk about, actually, let's screw that. Let's go straight to it. Since we already talking about Chicago, I want to get into the Chicago art scene. We talking about Chicago. I'm going to Chicago January 24th to do headline comedy at Zany's. I guess I should start that over for the rebroadcast when I clip this up. But I'm going to Chicago January 24th to perform and headline at Zany's Comedy Club. I need y'all in the building, but I also need to see the Chicago art scene because I'm going to be up there for a week, man. So I'm going to need some stuff to do out in the snow that's inside. So right now, I'm about to go to TikTok and see what is there to do in the Chicago art scene. Let's get it popping. Hold on. Somebody's got their music on there. Okay, she's going to her opening. Okay. I see black folk. I like it. That's a dope little hoodie. Okay, let me see what the caption says. Where is this at? Because this looks dope. To see so many beautiful, stylish black people in one place was so incredible. Okay, yeah. Let's keep. I'm going to keep watching this one. I'm coming in January. How cold is it going to be? I saw something about 27 in Chicago the other day. But we're looking for things to do in Chicago, specifically things within the art realm.
Hi, so I'm Veronica. I work at Woman Made Gallery in Chicago in University Village.
Okay.
And I'm going to show you around our Small Works member show. Oh, and I forgot to mention, all of these pieces are available for sale for $400 or less.
Nice. And this is Woman Made Gallery.
Now, Woman Made Gallery is a nonprofit feminist art gallery that has been around in Chicago since 1992. So,
nice. We'll put that on the list. Woman Made.
Okay, so here's my comprehensive list on, or I guess tutorial, on how to identify, attend, and enjoy yourself at art stuff in Chicago.
I like it. Let's get it.
If you're receptive and you're willing to be uncomfortable and you're willing to put yourself in these situations, you will find stuff to do in the city that you live in, promise. So to identify art things, there's a couple things that I do. And first is I go on Instagram and I initially followed every museum, every private gallery, every arts collective, every arts and culture nonprofit, every community initiative organization. And I actually whittled down over the course of several weeks and months and found which organizations I'm really passionate about. And now I have a really strong finger on the pulse, but generally just like follow organizations in your city that are interesting to you. Here's some in Chicago that I think are fantastic.
Hold up. Gallery Anthony, Institute Art Center, no, I'm sorry, Intuit Art Center, Richard Gray Gallery, Kavi Gupta, Patron Gallery, and ZG Gallery. All right, screenshot that real quick. I must do the same. And I'm definitely going to be checking them out.
And the reason I give this advice is because every gallery, and this is a great one in Chicago, is going to make their 5th to 10th post on a regular basis about an opening. And they're super fun, and they're a celebration, and they're usually open bar. So usually you'll see in-feed posts pertaining to a gallery opening in your city.
Hell yeah, I'm in there.
So what I do is I actually save them to collections on my Instagram, and then I go through the collection every Wednesday or so, and then I plan out my week because a lot of times they'll be in the same area and around the same time, and so you can go to multiple in one shot, and it is a ton of fun. Last thing about Instagram is that, like, the description sometimes
will show. I'm gonna fast forward to her next piece of advice. I think she got some more shit for us. Hold on.
Best friend. So I look at the Chicago Gallery News almost every week. There's The Visualist. There's Time Out Magazine. The Chicago Tribune will.
Crucial. This post is getting bookmarked.
The article Once in a Blue Moon, but I subscribe to a lot of these organizations and their newsletters as well. So it's just continuously doing this research and collection and figuring out what you want to go to moving forward. Okay, and my last piece of advice is the most annoying, which is that when you go to these art shows and these events, be receptive, be friendly, go alone to a percentage of them, because the friends I've made going to these events have brought me to the coolest things in the art world in Chicago.
That was really great. That was a really great clip. Let's shout her out. Her name on TikTok is Kush Kush Kush, spelled K-H-U-S-H. Kush Kush Kush. That was dope. That got me hyped for Chicago.
You're an artist. Yeah.
All right, hold on. Hyde Park Art Center. I turned the music off. Oh, that was hilarious. Okay. Somebody said they took a trip to the Hyde Park Art Center in Chicago. Okay, I love it. I love it. I love it. Solo date. They went to an art gallery. Chicago's only shape-shifting art exhibit. That's hard. Is that still up? I don't know if that's still up, but that's dope. This one's out. Art galleries. I'm going to look up some other stuff. Like, I want to look up some murals. Ooh, that's a dope exhibit. Who is this? That was in August. Oh, man, I'm getting excited about checking out art in Chicago. I'm going to look at some murals, too. Let's look at some Chicago murals. This is exciting. Let's see. Chicago murals. If you're just tuning into the live stream, it's a beautiful Tuesday morning. I am comedian Joshua Black. I'm coming to Chicago in January. January 24th, I'm headlining Zanies. I am one of the fastest upcoming comedians, aspiring comedians in America. Please come check me out. We are kicking it. We're doing giveaways. We're going to have sponsors. It's going to be a fun time. I'm bringing some of my boys with me. We might have a local comedian from Chicago do a little time. Make sure you tap in. Tickets going to be cheap. It's going to be a very, very fun time. Zany Chicago, January 24th. And I'm there all week, man, so holla at your boy. I'm looking at the art scene in Chicago. I know the fashion scene is off the charts, but I want to go check out some dope murals in Chicago, man. So I'm on TikTok now, and we're trying to find some of the dopest murals to go check out in Chicago. Hold on. People be having music. I can't play the music. Oh, that's hard. Most artsy neighborhood. I heard this. What part of Pilsen? That's what I looked up earlier. That's a little far from where I'm at. Not really, but Pilsen. That's dope. All right, check out Pilsen. All right, must visit Chicago.
Located on 70 to the 11th Street, this multi-pattern mural is the best photo backdrop.
All right. I'm going to just read that. Let me see. Make sure to visit when she's in Chicago because that music going to kill us. All right. Oh, that was just part one? Come on now. Damn, bro is doing the mural in the snow. He wilding. That's a beautiful piece, though. Look at the shadow work on that. That's hard. He getting it in the snow. Golly. Well, hell, I say that, but I was getting it in the sun. Nigga, I'm doing my first mural. It's about literally 100 degrees in Tennessee heat. Darn, they got the King Von mural. That's hard. That's hard. Yeah, this is dope, man. I'm getting excited. I'm getting excited about it. All right, and then the last thing, I want to check out the art museums. I know they got several of those. I was very close to going to one last time, but after me and my girl got engaged, I didn't really give a fuck about nothing else. We was chilling after that, so I said, fuck that. We did catch some shows out there. Like, it's a good theater town. We caught a dope theater show. Let me see. Art Museum, Chicago. Welcome to the live stream. It's your boy, Joshua Black. I'm headed to Chicago next month. We're looking at the dope art scene. I saw this one earlier. This is hard. I hope this is still there. It's an interactive exhibit, but this shit is hard. Going to Chicago Art Museum, not knowing what to expect. That's what I like to do. Fuck it, bro. Just roll up, blow one, just go in there. You don't know who's in there, what exhibits is happening. Just do it. Screw it, bro. Yeah, that's dope. We just saw that one. Well, I think I seen what I needed to see, man. I appreciate that. I'm hyped for Chicago, man. I want to thank y'all for tuning into the live stream. It is your ever so gracious host, Joshua Black. I'll see y'all later tonight every single day of the week. Well, at least Monday through Friday, we streaming 10 to 12, and then at nighttime, we're streaming a little later from about 9 to 11, but tap in, it's going down. It's your boy, Joshua Black. I'll see y'all next time. Peace.